All right. It is my privilege to introduce Robert Johnson today. He began his career working in the corporate world for IBM. He then felt called by God to get into ministry, and he was in the Bay Area. He said he was the oldest youth pastor in the Bay Area, got into ministry with Stan Long, serving there, had six kids in his youth group, but poured his heart and soul into those six. They're out doing amazing things in ministry now. But that six grew into 180, and just an amazing ministry out there. Went to Fuller Seminary, North Park Seminary, got ordained in the Evangelical Covenant Church, our larger church family that we are a part of, and moved to Kansas City and served as a pastor there for 7 years. And as he was there, he was starting to discern God's call on his life to be a chaplain, to be someone who could be with people in these sacred spaces of life and death together. He eventually went to Kansas University, received his doctorate and his training to be a chaplain, and about 10 years ago moved back to California, where he now serves as a director of pastoral care services at Emmanuel Medical Center in Turlock. And he serves not only the patients, but also the doctors, the nurses, the staff. It's a whole need for spiritual care in this incredible environment. He and I know each other from our time serving. We actually get to connect with each other. Covenant pastors in the area have a monthly meeting where we get to do that together. He's been married to his wonderful wife, Eunice, for 30 years. They have four daughters, six grandkids, two great-grandkids, and it is my pleasure to welcome you today, Reverend Dr. Robert Johnson.
Better? All right. God is good. Amen. Well, I'm happy to be here this morning. What can I say? Thank you for the invitation. It's always great to kind of hang out with people of God. Amen? That's a good day. I was telling one of the gentlemen when I was coming in the door, he said, it's a good day. I said, yes, I'm glad to be in it. I think the alternative is not that great. Praise the Lord. Amen. Well, I'm thankful to be here today. You know, about 3 years ago, prior to COVID, I got diagnosed for the fourth time, I think it was, right? Fourth time of prostate cancer. And I had a prayer. I said, Lord, I was the hospital asked me to dance, Turlock Dancing with the Stars. And so I had this diagnosis, and I was like, God, please help me. I don't know if I don't want to embarrass myself. I don't want to get out there and fall out in front of people. Lord, if you just give me enough strength just to be able to make it through the dance, I'll be satisfied. I'll try to conserve my energy as much as I can. And that prayer, and so after I prayed that prayer, I asked, I had a dance rehearsal. And so my wife had left, and she took the keys of my car. And she left with them in the car, with my wallet as well. I was going to call an Uber to get a ride to the dance studio. So I said, well, I got about a half hour. Better start walking because it's about three miles away. I hope I can do it. So I saw one of my neighbors out, and I was sharing. I said, look, I got to go to this dance rehearsal. And I only got about a half an hour to make it. And I'm trying to conserve my energy, so I need to be there. She says, well, you better get going. So I walked all the way to the studio, and we danced the whole hour. We got everything, you know, we practiced. And my poor teacher, she felt sorry for me. I was sweaty and the whole bit. She says, well, I'll give you a ride home. I said, thank you so much. So I got home, and that Saturday was the big event. We were ready to dance, and I was like, boy, I was feeling so fatigued. I was like, God, I just had a treatment. I don't know if I'm going to be able to make this thing. This is going to be something. Anyway, so God says, let me show you something. I won the competition. You know, that's how God does it. See, sometimes we as the people of God, we limit him. We limit his ability because we see him through our eyes. But what I'm going to share with you today is something that God wants you and I to do. He wants us to engage with him on a daily basis, every single day, because he wants to give us spiritual access. See, spiritual access happens to people who aren't the casual individuals. See, you can't get spiritual access. We all have access. Don't get the wrong idea. But spiritual access comes to the individual who is diligent, the individual who comes often, the individual who does not quit. Amen? I'm going to start preaching in a minute. I brought my wife with me. I want to introduce you. This is my wife, Eunice. She's been with me, as he said, about 30 years. Last week, I got a chance to celebrate my 29th birthday. So I was conceived during conception. Married during conception. So anyway, it's all good. It's all good. But let me just pray right now and ask God to allow his spirit to fill us, because that is the gasoline that gives us the spiritual connection. It's the spirit. God, our spirit. God, the Holy Spirit, I give you praise this morning because you are so good to us. And so, Lord, I'm praying right now that you touch each and every heart, every ear, and every spirit within this place, and allow us, Lord, to engage you in ways that we haven't. So, God, I'm asking blessings right now for me, just as you speak through me. I don't even want a word to be spoken from my lips, but, Lord, I want them to come from your heart. Lord, that they would come through and be uttered through me, but, Lord, let it ultimately be you, God, that says and does everything. So right now, God, I commit myself into your hands from the crown of my head to the soles of my feet. And I ask blessings for you, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit, I pray. Amen. Well, God is good. I'm going to just read these verses that I'm going to preach from in Acts 12, 1 through 10, okay? And now, at that time, Herod stretched out his hand to arrest some of from the church. He killed James, the brother of John, with a sword, and because he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to seize Peter also. And that was during the days of unleavened bread. So when he arrested him, he put him in prison and delivered him in the four squads of soldiers to keep him, intending to bring him out before the people for after the Passover. Peter, therefore, kept in prison, but constantly was in prayers offered by the church of God, amen. And when Herod was about to bring him out, that night he was sleeping, bound with two chains between the soldiers and the guards before him were kept in prison. Now, behold, an angel of the Lord stood by him, and a light shone in the prison. And it struck Peter on the side and raised him up and said, "Arise quickly." And the chains fell off his hands, and the angel said to him, "Gird yourself and tie on your sandals." So he did. And he said to him, "Put on your garment and follow me." And so he went out and followed him. He did not know what was done, but that by the angel was real. Angel, good stuff. But he thought he was seeing a vision. They were now past first and second guard posts, and they came out of the iron gates, which leads to the city. The gates opened on their own accord, and they went out and down the street, and immediately the angel left him. Interesting story. I'm so thankful that, you know, sometimes we think about how God just starts to use situations and people. We as the people of God have to be mindful that every instance God is ready to use us as individuals. A Christian lady lived next door to an atheist. And every day this Christian lady would pray. And she would pray. And many times the atheist would harass her. And he said, you're praying. It ain't no such thing as a God. I don't know why you're even praying. And so the lady would continue to pray, and she would always continue to pray. And it would just annoy this atheist. And he would say, "Okay, I'm going to get her. So he heard her praying, and she said, "You know what? I'm out of groceries. Lord, I need you to come and answer this prayer for me. I'm out of food." And so the atheist says, "I'll fix her." So he goes to the store, and he buys these groceries. And so she's praying, and then he takes these groceries, And while she's out there, he takes these groceries, he sits them on a porch, and he runs and he hides. And she comes out and she gets the groceries. And she says, "Oh, thank you, God. Thank you for the blessing that you've given me. Oh, God, you're faithful. You're sure." And the atheist jumps out of the bush and says, "Aha! I'm the one who bought those groceries. You didn't buy those groceries." And he says, and she started to rejoice all the more, "Oh, God, I give you praise. Because thank you for the groceries you bought me, but I didn't know that you were going to use the devil to bring them." Sometimes God will use the most unlikely resources to get his point across. As chaplain of the hospital, it is a fine line in the spiritual realm that in which I serve. Many times I don't have a clue as to what's going to happen during the course of a day. I never do. But one thing I know that I need to do each and every day is to plug into the source. So each morning I was sharing with Scott, I get up around 3 o'clock every morning, even this morning. I get up and I spend time with God. I want to get connected. I just start talking to him about all kinds of things. Whatever's on my mind, on my heart, on my spirit, I start talking to him about that stuff. And the Lord is so faithful to meet me. You know, it's interesting how individuals come to me for prayer a lot, and they'll say, "Wow, you know, I am not hearing from God. I don't know what he's not saying anything to me right now. Just, you know, how do you hear from God?" Oops, got to make sure I get this. Thank you, God. Anyway, God, you got to make sure that I'm hearing from God. "Sir, how do you hear from God?" And I'm always saying, "Well, you know what? My thing is, I wish he would shut up sometimes, because he's talking to me a lot. He's always pouring into me these different things." But being the chaplain at the hospital, I have to pour into God, because I have no idea of what I'm going to experience during the course of a day. You know, just in the course of a day, there may be a death here, or there may be a person that needs encouragement here. There may be a doc that's going through something that he just needs an encouraging word. And so many times, I don't know what people need, but God always pours into me exactly what they need. If that makes sense to you, one of the things that I do is every morning I read the Word of God. For the last, one of my children, one of my youth ministry students asked me one time, he says, "Pastor Johnson, have you ever, you know the Bible?" I said, "Yeah, I love the Bible, love the Word of God. That's my thing, man. That's what I do every day." He says, "Well, have you ever read it all the way through?" And a hush went over Jerusalem. I hadn't read it all the way through from cover to cover, as he asked me, and I had to tell him I hadn't done that. That was in 2003. I've read the Bible every year through since then. And every year I learned some more stuff. Every day I learn some more stuff. You know, when Herod, this Herod we're talking about, you know that he was the brother of Herodias? You know who Herodias was? She was the one responsible for John the Baptist's death. Wow. Thank you, God. Tidbit. God wants to continue to add caveats into our lives so that we can gain spiritual strength. And when we gain spiritual strength, we gain a boldness. And when we gain a boldness, people will come and ask us, "What must I do to be saved? What must I do to get on the gain eternal life? What must I do to have this relationship with Jesus?" I'm going to share with you three things. In order to have spiritual, this spiritual access, first, we have to be in relationship with God first. Engage in relationship with God is reading the Word, being involved with the Word, knowing the Word of God, being just available to the Word of God. Of course, the Holy Spirit, God, the Holy Spirit, is our instructor. And he's constantly using the Word along with the Spirit to usher us along, to help us. And many times, I don't even know what to ask for. When I'm praying, I don't know what to ask for. God just says, "You see that lady over there? she needs you. It was like on Thursday. I was at the hospital, minding my own business as always. And I was called to come to this room, 173, bed one, bed A, I go. And the lady's there and she smiles. And sometimes God will allow you to see through these fake smiles. We have these fake facades that we put on like everything is great. And so I just said, "Hi, sweetheart. How can I help you? How can I serve you?" And her countenance changed. And I could see just the depression of pain just going through her face. And I knew she had a diagnosis. She hadn't said it yet. She was even on the wrong floor as far as being in the area for diagnosis for this particular type of thing. She wasn't even in the right department. She was on the surgical floor. But she found out that she had cancer. Wow. You should have saw the air leave the room. "I've got cancer." And I said, "Honey, so do I. This is my fourth one. But you know what? If you want me to, if you will allow me to, I will walk with you through this cancer. Because God, obviously, wants me to do that with you." Isn't that how the devil works? He always wants to get in the middle of stuff when you're trying to make a point, right? I tell you. But, you know, and so, yes, yeah, so many times God is, he's dealing with these situations with people, just like this woman, and he's saying, "You've got to come in and help this person do what they need to do." Amen. I'm so blown away at how God is so thorough and how he moves in it. Cancer is not a death sentence. Many times we as individuals, God wants us to be spiritually sensitive so we can hear when another individual needs to hear from God. Many times you are the voice, you are the hands, you are the ears, you are the touch that God wants to use in order to serve individuals. See, we're not here, I'm not here, you're not here to be for ourselves. We're here for one another. Amen? So, in the second verse, when we talk about James and John, did you know that these two individuals are the son of the thunder the sons of thunder that God was speaking about? John, of course, Herod didn't kill. What made that different? Well, Peter, I'm sorry, Herod didn't kill. Killed James. So what made that different? It was the prayers. It was the prayers. Many times, the prayers of the righteous availeth much. Amen? Amen. Amen. So, James and John were two of Jesus' original disciples, and they asked Jesus for special recognition. You remember that? He says, "Can I be at your right hand or your left?" And Jesus told him, basically, there's something that you're going to have to do. You're going to have to go through some special kinds of pain or torture or to, in order to do this, but that right is not for me to give to anyone. That right is reserved for my Father only. But you will experience the same cup of suffering that I suffer. Of course, James was exiled and James was killed during the Passover, the time of unleavened bread. Now, what made that significant? Because see, Herod had this audience. He had this big audience of which he could really just not only take Peter out, but he could display, hey, look, sometimes we have an audience. We want to definitely take and appease these people. And then if they start to say, "Well, wow, you're doing good. Things are going great. You know, I like what you're doing." We will start to even add on, or we'll start to move even in a higher level of torture or just castigating these enemies. But the fact is, we got to be careful as to not get caught up into moving with folk as people tend to want us to move. See, many times, I want to appease you. I want to make you feel good. I want to make you experience me. That's not what God wants us to experience. He wants us to experience him. So the fact is, we've got to move back into that realm. When I had to share a story with you, before I came to Kansas City, I mean, to California, I was asked to go to a prison. And this sixth verse tells me a little bit. When Peter was laying next to the soldiers, he was sleeping. I was at Angola prison, which I volunteered for 1 week. I spent 1 day on death row, 1 day in maximum security, and the rest in the general population. When I found out that I was going to Angola prison, now Angola prison is one of the most notorious prisons in the United States. My wife and I prayed prior to me going that I'd be able to get out. I mean, you know, to escape safely. So the first day I was on death row, and I was with this one inmate, and he had been on death row for 14 years. But he found out, he says, "I'm going to get out." And I was thinking that there was an inmate who was executed earlier that day who asked to be executed because he was just burned out and tired of living in that environment. And so what happened, this inmate was eventually released, which was true, after 14 years of prayer. They finally figured out he was the one who didn't commit this particular crime. During the course of that, I moved from maximum security, death row into maximum security, and just got a chance to see how God uses prison. Now, check this out. The day that I knew I was going into the prison, the day before I couldn't sleep, I didn't sleep a wink. I don't even think I slept a wink the whole time I was there. Now, Peter's laying next to two guards, laying right between them, and you wonder, what gave this guy this peace? Why was he so content at where he was? One of the things that was happening to him is that he remembered. One of the things, he was so connected to the Word of God that he remembered that Jesus told him that he would not age, that he would think about the time when he was a young man, and he would go where he wanted to go, when he wanted to go, and how he wanted to go, and someone would have to lead him during this particular time. He said, "Truly I say to you, when you were younger, you used to gird yourself and walk wherever you wished, and you would go and grow old and stretch out your hand, and someone else would gird you and bring you where you didn't want to go. But now," he said, this is signifying what kind of death would glorify. So Peter is going through some real changes here. He's going through some changes here. Praise God. He was telling Peter he would not die as a young man, but as an old man. So Peter, one of the things, like I said, we have to be connected to the Word in order to go back and grab hold of those truths that get us successful. So those are the things that really enhance our prayers and allow us to grow in those areas for which God has addressed. So Peter knew the promises Jesus had made to him over 12 years ago. And so Peter could go to sleep because he believed that God would do what he said he would do. Many times, if we don't have that anchor, if we don't have that source, if we haven't girded ourselves in the Word of God, we won't have that foundation in order to hold on to be able to stand. So that formula, that concept of prayer, the Word through the Holy Spirit is a formula for true spiritual access. Like the thing that happened, see, the angel that came to fetch Peter, but prayer fetched the angel. See, the fact is, the angel wouldn't come unless the prayer was beginning. See, many times we just don't understand that God wants us to be so engaged with him that he wants to speak to us through the Spirit. And if we're connected to him on a daily basis, he can speak to us in the Spirit. And when he speaks to us in the Spirit, we know that it's from him because it lines up with the Word of God, and the Spirit will give us the access to allow us to know that it's true. See, the fact is that it's that engagement with God on a daily basis that helps us know that spiritual access is possible. See, this touching, sometimes I asked God to touch me right before the eyes of some of the people that I experienced. Now, in my realm, there are many times when I don't have answers for people. I don't have the answers for anything. All I do is come in and be a conduit for someone who needs prayer. They say, Robert, look, I got a cancer diagnosis. I got an emotional issue. I've got whatever. But the fact is, God has shown up for me on every single occasion, and he will show up for you as well. The fact is, we just got to ask. Sometimes God wants us to take our pride and crush it, because many times I won't go to God on my own strength. It takes sometimes some crushing to make me move into that realm. It's just like when I was moving into chaplaincy. You know what brought me to chaplaincy? It was the crushing. And sometimes God allows things to close in on us so that we can ask him, Lord, I need to hear your voice. I need to know where you're going. I want to understand how you want to bring me through. Many times we can't understand that on this side. When I'm saying on this side, absent from spirituality. We have to be engaged in the spirit in order to understand what God is trying to take us or where God is trying to move us. So God is saying, sometimes I have to use some instruments, some things that I don't like to use that'll make you move in the way you need to do. And so God will say, I'm going to take a little pain and I'm going to just give you a little dose of it to make you move in this direction. Well, what God did for me to make me move in the chaplaincy, he says, look, you fulfill your purpose here. But sometimes we don't understand that our purpose or that particular assignment is done. And God will continue to nudge us, and he'll continue to nudge us, and he'll continue to nudge us. And then at this particular time, he nudged me to a point where he says, I'm going to take this church and I'm going to close it, because I got another purpose for you for which you have not even a clue or even understand right now. And I didn't. And the fact was, God was trying to move me into a level of chaplaincy. My wife had been telling me for 3 years, you need to be a chaplain. And I said, I'm a pastor. I don't need to be no chaplain. I don't know what chaplains do. Chaplains pray. God has taken me to a whole new level of prayer. God allowed cancer to be that voice call for me, to allow me to have this sacred little time of, God, I need you not more than ever. I need you right now. I need you every moment. God is a God who wants to be in relationship with us. And for us to have the spiritual access, we've got to be in relationship with him. We've got to call on him. I asked God, I says, God, if you would do this one thing for me, this one thing that I ask, I want to develop a hunger for you. I want to develop a desire for you. And see, that comes through reading the word of God, through prayer, and through engaging in God's spirit. And then asking God for spiritual sensitivity to be able to understand what he's saying, how he's saying it, and when he's saying it. And then being able to discern the voices, because the only way I can discern the voices which are poured out to me is through the word of God. See, the word of God is the discerner. It's the one that breaks down all those different nuances so I can see clearly. He's the one who makes the crooked places smooth, straight, and the rough places smooth, and he reveals his day to each and every one of us, and we're going to all see it together. But the fact is, we've got to be engaged with this word. It's this word that transformed us. See, many times the desires that I have aren't God's desires. And so I have to learn God's desires through God's word. And then God engages me in the spirit. And through the spirit, I ask God to engage me back so that we can have this dialogue, this conversation. And God, it's amazing. I will leave the prayer room in the morning, and I will come out, and I will go to the hospital, and I'll meet someone for the very first time. Never engaged with them one moment in my life. And the fact is, God has already given me the instructions in my heart to be able to share with them the things that they need to move into that realm of success. The realm of success in our economy is not like it is in the world. See, sometimes God uses things from small beginnings. Many times he uses these metaphors like mustard seeds to tell us that I'm going to do these small beginnings to grow you into an individual. He used me in that same way. Hey, just like you, just like me, I didn't know revelations from Genesis when I first started. And then the fact is, God is saying, look, now not only do you know revelation from Genesis, you can lead individuals to the truth. And the fact is, God wants to pour truth into you. And we've got to engage God on a daily basis in order to experience that truth. That's how he does it. God loves you more than anything on the planet. There's nothing that he wouldn't give up for you, because he gave up his one and only son, that you and I might be able to have life, and have life abundantly, have it to the full. One of the things we need to ask ourselves, do we have our prayer life strong enough to move prison doors? Is our prayer life strong enough to handle the discords of a broken life? Is our prayer life strong enough to handle the pain of just the daily walk of life? Is our prayer strong enough? See, prayer life is our blood life. It's our spiritual blood life. It's the spiritual access that we have to the kingdom of God. God wants to take us to a level higher than anything we ever thought we would know. He wants to engage you and me in this brother and sisterly love, for which we do not let all these outside interferences deal with us. See, the fact is, we need God's word in order to block out distractions, because the distractions come in lies and they come in all other sorts of things. But the truth, the word of God says, will set us free. And the better and the more we know the truth, we're able to gain spiritual access. Spiritual access is a marvelous thing, because what happens in it, through spiritual access, we're able to help other people, help other individuals gain not only the knowledge of Jesus Christ, but we allow them to experience salvation to the full. See, the fact is, we're not here for ourselves. I'm not here for myself. And when we learn that, we are not here for ourselves, we can be these instruments that God can use to edify and build a kingdom. And not only that, but to transform community. We all have been transformed to a degree. One of the things that God wants us to do in our time with him on a daily basis is one step at a time being transformed into image of his son. Christians, brothers and sisters, yeah, we're brothers and sisters. We live in the moment, and we've got to learn how to live in the moment. And the moment that we live in is a moment of love. Because, see, many times we only have one opportunity to show that. We only have one opportunity to reflect God's grace, God's love, God's presence, God's just his whole being. We are God's hands. We are God's feet. We are God's ears, God's mouth, God's eyes. We are God's children. And we have attributes to reflect who God is. There's a whole community out here that needs to hear from you. They need to hear your story. They need to hear how you've accomplished, how the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, has made you a conqueror, how the Holy Spirit has made you victorious, how the Holy Spirit is holding you together. Now, one of the things that God wants us all to do also is to be honest. Hey, I don't have it all together. I wish I did. But what I do know, this I share, that Jesus Christ is the greatest thing that's ever happened in my life. I was a lost, wandering generality until I met Jesus. I wanted it my way, and I found out it wasn't Burger King. You know, the fact is, that's what I wanted. But now I want it God's way. Not my will, Lord, but your will be done. Because I found out that his will is a better way to serve. I found out that his will is a better way to touch, teach, love, and share. God is a great God. I'm just so grateful to be here with you this morning. I'm praying that God will just touch you in a way that you've never experienced him before. See, God will let you in this throne room, this great place of transition. What he allows me to see, this place of spiritual and physical, and where they intersect and transition, it's a place, I tell you, it's like no other place. It's a place for which God allows spiritual access. Oh, I wish I could show you a video. I wish I could allow you to stand over my shoulder. I wish you could be just this invisible person that could hang out like God and I'll be over my shoulders and see what God is doing in the spiritual realm. He wants to do that through you. He wants to do that through you. He wants to do that through us because we are His. We belong to Him. Join me in a word of prayer. Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you for the honor to come to you, Lord, and just share your word. Lord, I pray that you'd use each of us in a way, God, that we never even expected to live or to work. I pray, God, that you touch us and allow us to experience you and the fullness of Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, and God the Father. I ask this in the powerful name of our Lord, I pray. Amen.